We want to get straight to a today weather alert for Queensland with more rain on the radar this morning after the southeast was again smashed by storms and flash flooding.
Andrea Crothers is following the forecast for us. Andrea, Queenslanders just seem like they can't catch a break.
Yeah, and we're not in the clear yet, guys. The Bureau is forecasting possible severe thunderstorms as well as heavy rainfall for parts of the southeast interior, as well as all the way from Claremont in central Queensland up to Hughenden in the northwest. But we know the southeast was absolutely battered yesterday. Those snap storms saw falls of up to 136 millimetres in just 3 hours in places like Springfield Lakes. Now, that caused flash flooding, cutting roads all the way from Ipswich and between Brisbane as well there. Meanwhile, the federal government and state, they have also announced a $20 million cleanup program to help in the hardest hit areas around the scenic rim, Logan, Gold Coast, as well as the state's far north, guys.
Andrea, thank you.
In Queensland's far north, meantime, the Prime Minister is sending in federal reinforcement after seeing devastation firsthand. Anthony Albanese pledging an extra $20 million for flood and storm cleanup. ADF personnel will also be deployed in the Douglas, Cook and Woodrell-Woodrell regions, as well as two army helicopters to help transport supplies and deliver engineering equipment into isolated communities. Floodwater warnings across Victoria, moving from emergency to watch and act, especially in Rochester, Seymour and Yay. But residents are still on alert in Rochester after a miraculous rescue of a 74-year-old grandmother clinging to a tree branch, saved just in time by a hero farmhand. The hero jumping to action after the Rochester floods began to submerge her car.
Once I got to her, she was clinging to a branch. She'd sort of just gotten out of the car. I ran back to my ute, and the neighbour and Gilly had got there, grabbed a snatchy strap off him and then jumped back into the water and made my way back to her, sinking at a fairly rapid rate as well. So I knew something had to be done.
She would not be alive without Mitch today at all. He is an absolute lifesaver.
The woman was taken to hospital but is now home safe. Police urging people to not travel through closed off roads. The country's supermarket giants will today be put on notice by the federal government in an effort to tackle the cost of living crisis. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese today expected to announce a review into the industry's code of conduct. The review will also look at how the grocery chains handle complaints.
Now to another shark attack in South Australia. A surfer recovering this morning after being bitten off the Eyre Peninsula coast. Michaela Kamarek is live outside the Royal Adelaide Hospital this morning. Hello, Michaela. He first drove himself to hospital.
He sure did, Clinton. Good morning to you. It's understood the 64-year-old local man was surfing with the mate at Elliston on South Australia's Eyre Peninsula when he was attacked just after 3:30 yesterday afternoon. He got out of the water and, as you said, managed to take himself to the local hospital where he was treated for leg injuries before being flown to Adelaide and transported here to the Royal Adelaide Hospital where he's undergoing further treatment. Now, photos posted online show the extent of damage to his surfboard, and looking at those pictures, it's quite remarkable he's managed to escape with non-life-threatening injuries. Now, this is yet another shark attack in South Australian waters. We've had six in less than a year, with three of them deadly. Clint?
It's an extraordinary tale. Thanks, Michaela.
Well, breaking overnight, a 17-year-old boy is in hospital this morning. The teen allegedly assaulted on the Gold Coast overnight. He suffered non-life-threatening injuries during a disturbance in Upper Coomera. Police say it's likely multiple people were involved. All are known to each other. A man has died snorkeling along a beach in Melbourne. The search at Altona Beach began just after 5 p.m. Two rescue helicopters, rescue jet skis and police divers and boats eventually finding his body. Police are not treating the death as suspicious. A man has been hospitalised with face and head injuries, an alleged assault in Sydney's east. The 43-year-old found in a home on Yorktown Parade in Maroubra around 1:30 a.m. before being taken to St Vincent's Hospital. Anyone with information is urged to contact police or Crime Stoppers. Well, three teenagers have been rescued after they became stuck in a telecommunication tower in Melbourne around 10:30 last night. The trio gained entry to the 50-metre tall structure on Bay Road at Cheltenham. Police, firefighters, hazmat and lift technicians all on scene, freeing the boys after 2 hours. No injuries have been reported. Police are investigating a suspected shooting in Adelaide's north around 2 a.m. Officers were called to a property on Nelson Street in Kilburn after a woman was found with leg injuries before locating a torched car on Brown Lane in West Croydon. It is understood no arrests have been made.
The promise to monitor young offenders with electronic monitoring devices has been quietly dropped by the Victorian government. Today, Melbourne reporter Isabella Stashkovsky is live for us from Melbourne. Isa, this goes against their 2018 election promise.
It certainly does, Jane. Good morning to you. But the state government says that the situation is different now to what it was back in 2018. That is despite recent police statistics showing a 30% increase in crimes by youths aged 14 to 17. One of the worst offenders is a 15-year-old who has been arrested 33 times on 135 different matters. The state opposition has, as you'd imagine, slammed this move, but the state government is adamant it is the right call, Jane, saying that we do have one of the lowest youth crime rates in the country.
Isa, thank you.
Police are increasing the presence of sniffer dogs at music festivals in Victoria after 9 people overdosed at an event in Melbourne. Speaking to the Age newspaper, an industry source says a boosted police presence will target Juicy Fest this Friday. 4 people hospitalised at the weekend remain in a critical condition.
Former President Donald Trump is in Washington, D.C. court this morning to find out whether or not he's immune from criminal prosecution.
I feel that as a president, you have to have immunity. Very simple. And if you don't, as an example, if this case were lost on immunity and I did nothing wrong, absolutely nothing wrong, I'm working for the country.
Let's get the latest this morning from 9 US correspondent Alison Petrowski, who's following the drama. Ali, good morning. Trump back in court again.
Yeah, good morning to you, Clint. Welcome to 2024. Donald Trump back in the courthouse this morning. These were just legal arguments that were being heard in the DC courthouse, Clint. There was no requirement for the former president to be there, but he did decide he wanted to go and listen in and then hold a press conference. Donald Trump's lawyers were arguing that Trump was acting within the realms of his presidency when he attempted to overturn the 2020 election. They also presented an interesting legal argument saying US presidents should only be criminally charged, Clint, if they were impeached and convicted while in office. Now, that legal argument prompted a lot of back and forth between Trump's lawyers and the 3 appellate judges overseeing this. The appellate judges presented a series of hypotheticals regarding when a US president could and couldn't be criminally charged.
Could a president order SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political rival? That's an official act in order to SEAL Team 6.
He would have to be and would speedily be, you know, impeached and convicted before the criminal prosecution.
But if you weren't, there would be no criminal prosecution, no criminal liability for that.
Chief Justice's opinion in Marbury against Madison and our Constitutional Tradition and the plain language of the impeachment judgment clause all clearly presuppose that what the founders were concerned about was not.
I asked you a yes or no question. Could a president who ordered SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political rival who was not impeached, would he be subject to criminal prosecution?
If he were impeached and convicted first. And so
your answer is no.
My answer is qualified yes. There's a political process that would have to occur.
Look, that argument is a slippery slope for Donald Trump's legal team, Clint. That hearing has wrapped up for today. It lasted a little over an hour. And look, no decision expected in that appeals case until next month at the earliest. Donald Trump now headed to Iowa. He will be campaigning there tomorrow ahead of the Iowa caucus. And then on Friday, he finds himself back in the courtroom once again, this time in New York, to hear the closing arguments for his civil trial. So look, Donald Trump bouncing between the campaign trail and the courthouse and continuing to suck out the oxygen of the Republican race for the nomination.
Ali, thank you so much.
Customers have been left thousands of dollars out of pocket after cyber criminals compromised accounts with fashion retailer The Iconic. With unauthorised access to customer details, criminals have made transactions without the customers even knowing. The retailer saying that it has not fallen victim to a cyber attack and it will refund any customer affected. Former Prime Minister Scott Morrison is calling on international political heavyweights to endorse his new book, with former US Vice President Mike Pence enlisted to write its foreword. The Christian tell-all, titled Plans for Your Good, A Prime Minister's Testimony of God's Faithfulness, is due to be released later this year. Well, Sydney Airport has been slammed as one of the world's worst terminals by a former politician who had to wait 20 minutes. Today's Jack Hahn is following this absolutely shocking story this morning. Jack, we're talking about the former treasurer, former US ambassador Joe Hockey. He wasn't happy. What happened?
Well, look, Jane, when you think of long lines and chaotic queues, a few airports come to mind, right? JFK, LAX, maybe even Atlanta in the United States. But according to Joe Hockey, forget about all of those American airports, Sydney takes the top spot of one of the world's worst. And why is that? Well, as you pointed out, the poor diddums had to wait 20 minutes, yes, 20 minutes, to get aboard a flight to Japan. It sparked fire and fury from the former politician and, as you mentioned, US ambassador and treasurer. Now, Sydney Airport is pretty keen to point out that 100% of domestic passengers at the moment are making it through security within just 10 minutes, and 99% of people are walking through that hallway, making it through security and getting to duty-free within 10 minutes as well. But team, listen up. I think we need to put all of this to bed and do a bit of investigative journalism this morning. So how's this? I've got my passport. Maybe you could book me on a flight to, say, LA, Singapore, something like that. I'll walk through, time it, and I can FaceTime you when I'm getting aboard the aircraft. How's that sound?
Jack, I mean, I might need
to, work to do
go
here.
Upstairs for approval on that one, yeah. But I like the way you're thinking.
Yeah, you look like more of a Bali kind of guy, Jack.
Yeah, I could do Bali. I could do Bali.
He's not picky. There we go. That's good to know.
Bon voyage, Jack. Thank you.
Anything. Yeah.